In the year 1907, you know, the Henry Moseley was the first scientist. He built a modern periodic table. Their outermost shell are incomplete and also known as main group element or the typical groups of element. The S block elements are those in which last electrons will be enters into the s orbital. Hello my dear students, a warm welcome you all. Myself is Poornima, lecturing Department of Chemistry at Vidyashram Pre University College, Temple of Excellence, Mysuru. My dear students, in our last discussion, we were dealing with the unit called classifications of the elements and periodicity in property. Under that, we have studied about the introductory part of the periodic table, and also we have understood about the significance of classification. Already we have understood that the classifications of the elements is very important for the chemistry student to learn about the each and every elements which has been placed in a particular order to study about their physical and the chemical property. If not, it become a very difficult for us to learn about the a particular elements which has been placed in a periodic table. Is it right? So by use of this periodic table, we can study any other material with the physical and the chemical property. So that is all about the significance. In addition to that, we also discussed about the history of development of the periodic table. Under that, mainly we have discussed about the three different scientists. The first one is the Dobonier, Trias, and also we have discussed about the Newland law of octaves, and also we discussed about the Mendeleev law for the periodic table. So these three scientists, they have given their own ideas to build a periodic table. Today we are going forward to learn about the modern periodic table, and also we are going to understand about the modern periodic law. Under that, we are going to discuss with the what is a period and what is a group, and also we are going to discussing about the classifications of the elements in the periodic table, which means to say that how do we classify the elements into S, P and D block elements. Let us discuss in this session. First and foremost, I'll go for the modern periodic table. So this modern periodic table was given by the scientist called as Henry Moseley in the year 1907. In the year 1907, you know, the Henry Moseley was the first scientist. He built a modern periodic table. While doing in his own experiment, while studying the X-ray diffractions or the X-ray studies of the particular elements, you know, he found out that. So while he measuring the frequency of X-ray given for the different elements, he found out that he plot a graph of a frequency versus atomic number. Frequency, the square root of frequency, that is mu, versus atomic number. He found out that he plot a graph, and this graph will be linear in nature. Is it right? So the Henry Moseley in the year 1907, he was studying the different kinds of the element, and also he is studying about the X-ray diffraction studies of the elements. While studying this, you know, he come to know that while plotting the graph of the square root of frequency versus atomic number, he come to know that the graph will be linear in nature. Again, he plot the graph by considering the square root of frequency versus atomic mass. So he did not get a graph at all. So later he come to the conclusion that atomic number is a fundamental part for the classifications of the element. While classifying these elements, we need to consider the atomic number. So which is a fundamental part for the chemistry. Let's see how did he say with the statement. He plotted the square root of the X-ray frequency against the atomic number. He got a straight line, and while relating the frequency with the atomic mass, he did not get anything. And finally, based on his experiment, Moseley stated that atomic number is a fundamental property of an element and not it is a atomic mass. Already we have learned that the three different scientists, that is the Daubonnier, Newland as well as with the Mendeleev, all these three scientists, you know, they have given that atomic mass is very much important for classifying the element. But later on, Henry Moseley, he says that instead of taking the atomic mass, if you consider the atomic number, it is very easy to classify the element based upon the increasing in a atomic number. So this idea was given by the Henry Moseley in the year 1907. How did he get the idea? Because he is not at all studying about the periodic table. Interestingly, he was studying about the X-ray diffraction studies. And on that experiment, he come to know that while plotting the square root of frequency versus atomic number, he got a linear graph, isn't it? But again, he plotted the graph of frequency versus atomic mass and did not find any graph at all or any linear line at all. Later, he come to know that based on his experiment, atomic number is a fundamental property of an element, not the atomic mass. Later, you know, he found out his own law for periodic table, and later it is considered as a modern periodic law. Let's see what is the modern periodic law states. The chemical and the physical properties of the elements are the periodic functions of their atomic number. So, according to the Henry's law, he says that the chemical and the physical properties of the elements are the periodic functions of their atomic number, not on the atomic mass. Okay, so this was a clear idea was given by the great scientist called as Henry Moseley. Okay, hope you are understood with the general introduction to the modern periodic table along with the modern periodic law. What does the modern periodic law states? The chemical and the physical properties of the elements are the periodic functions of the atomic number instead of atomic mass. Let's see how does our modern periodic table will be looks. So this is a complete picture about the modern periodic table. So let's see which are the things we need to learn from this table in the next slide. That is, when you look into the modern periodic table, the two things we need to understand. One is the group as well as the period. Let's see what is the group now. Groups are nothing but a vertical column. So here you can see that there are 18 vertical columns will be there in the modern periodic table. They are considered as a group. They are considered as what? Group. So how many groups are there? You can see here there are vertical lines are present. You know, there are from 1 to 18 vertical columns will be there in our modern periodic table, and is known as a group. Understood? Next, the group has been numbered as from 1 to 18. How it has been numbered? It has been numbered from 1 to 18. And also, the group 1, which is extremely at the left, which contains the alkali elements. So now let's see how to name this, the group 1 to group 18 now. Okay, so how many groups are there in the modern periodic table? Remember, this vertical columns are known as groups. There are 18 groups will be there in the modern periodic table. The first group that will be start here from the hydrogen, and it has been named as alkali metals. It will be named as what? Alkali metal. Whereas this group 2 elements, they are known as alkaline earth metal. They are named as what? Alkaline earth metal. So this is what actually says about the group 1 and the group 2. So at the left side you can see that from the hydrogen it will start. Okay, that is the group 1. They are known as what? Alkali metals. Why they are known as alkali metal? These are the metal when they react with the water, you know, they form the alkali. Whereas in case of the group 2, you know, they are known as a alkaline earth metal because when they react with the water, you know, they forms a very weak alkali. Hence, it is named as a strong alkali. Hence, it is known as a alkaline earth metal. Now, you can see that all the elements which has present in this group, they have a similar electronic configuration and they have a same number of valence electron. First, I'll go for the first group of element. I'll consider the example of the hydrogen. Atomic mass of the hydrogen is 1. Atomic number of hydrogen is 1. Is it right? How to write the electronic configuration? We know the this is a structure for the hydrogen. Is it right? At the K shell, it consists of only one electron. Is it right? I'll consider the next one, that is the lithium. This is for the lithium. For the K shell, it can accommodate only 2, followed by the L shell, where it consists of only one electron. If you observe the hydrogen and lithium, you can clearly see that at outermost electron, it consists of only one valence electron. That is why all the group 1 elements, they are having a one valence electron on its own valence shell. On the valence shell, all the group 1 elements, they have a one valence electron. You can consider the group 2 elements also. I'll take the example of beryllium. Okay. What is the atomic number of beryllium? 4. So, this is a K shell can accommodate only 2, whereas the L shell can accommodate 8. So, it consists of another 2. You can take the example of the magnesium also. Magnesium, where consider this is as a K shell, can accommodate only 2, followed by L. So, if you fill K shell as for the 2 electron, for the L shell, you can fill 8 electron. Is it right? Because for the magnesium, atomic number is 12. Is it right? So, you can fill 8 electron. Is it right? So, 2 plus 2, 2 plus 8, it is 10. For the last shell, that is for the M shell, you can fill 18 electron. So, it occupies 2 electron. Remaining 2 electron can be occupied in the L shell. This shows that if you compare the beryllium with the magnesium, you can see that the last shell, which consists of only 2 electron, that is why it is named as group 2 element. All these elements, they have a 2 valence electron on its outermost shell. So, this is what actually this statement was mean, that all the elements in the periodic table, in the group especially, you know, they have a similar electronic configuration with that of the number of valence electron. If you go on writing for the calcium and magnesium and strontium also, you will find out that only 2 electrons will be there in the outermost shell. This is how he explained the groups in the periodic table. Hope you have understood with the group 1 and with the group 2. The elements in the group 1 and 2 on the left hand side, and next the group 3 to group 3 to group 12. Group 3 to group 12, they are known as transition element. They are known as what? Transition element. And this one is known as alkali metals. This one is known as alkaline earth metals. Okay. After this 12, you can see that the group 13 to group 17, group 13 to group 17, they are also known as representative elements. They are known as representative elements, or it is also known as main group element. It is also known as main group element. Their outermost shell are incomplete and also known as main group element or the typical groups of element. So remember, the group 1 elements are known as alkali metal, whereas the group 2, it is known as alkaline earth metal. The group 3 to group 12, they are known as transition elements. Group 13 to group 18, actually it is from group 13 to group 17, if you consider, they are known as a main group element. Group 18 elements are known as noble gases. They are known as noble gases. Then, the elements which are present in group 3 to 12, as I have explained, the group 3 to 12, they are known as transition element. They are known as what? Transition element. And these elements, where the electrons are added to the incomplete shell. So where the electrons will be goes to the inner shell, hence it is named as a transition element. Okay, the group 3 to group 12, they are known as transition element. And also the group 18 element on the right hand side, you can see that this is a group 18 element, that is a helium, neon, argon, krypton, xenon and radon, they are known as noble gases. They are known as what? Noble gases. They are also known as zero group element or the inert gases. Because these are the element, you know, they never react with any other element. Hence it is known as the noble gases or the inert gases, or we can call it as a zero group element also. Next, we'll see with the inner transition element, which means to say that after learning about this, you know, groups, there are 18 groups will be there. But if you can see in that periodic table, there is a separate two table which has been placed. Why they have placed here? Only because in the group 3, especially on the 6th period, one of the element is there known as lanthanum. So, which exhibits in a different atomic state. So, which can exhibit in a 14 different possible way. Hence, it has been named as lanthanides. They are known as what? Lanthanides. So, it will be start from lanthanum to lanthanum. And it will be start from cesium to lutetium. Usually the series are known as a cesium to lutetium. Since it starts from the lanthanum, hence it is known as lanthanide series or the lanthanides. Okay. It is also known as inner transition element, where this element which is further divided into 14 element. Hence it has been placed separately in our periodic table. Where it is present? On the group 3 on the 6th period. Okay. They are called as a lanthanide, and they have placed with the element called as lanthanum with the atomic number 57 with the same position, because they are very much resembles with each other. Since they show the similar characteristics, you know, they have placed separately on the periodic table. And however, for our convenience sake, we have placed below in the periodic table. And also, you can see that another one of the element known as actinium. So, which also consists of the 14 element, which also consists of what? 14 element. It will be start from thorium to lutetium. Thorium to lutetium. So, this is known as actinides. This is known as what? Actinide. And this is also belonging to the inner transition series. These two series are also known as inner transition series. They are also known as what? Inner transition series, where the actinium, which is also resembled with the other 14 elements, hence they have placed below in the periodic table. This is how in our periodic table we have classified the groups into 18. Okay, how many groups will be there? 18 groups will be there, and each group has its own name. Okay, but in addition to this, we have observed that there is a separate 14 groups of element which has been placed below the periodic table. They are known as the inner transition element, because this, especially on the group 3, the lanthanum as well as with the actinium, these two elements, they show the different kinds of 14 elements, and they are almost similar in their nature. That is why they have placed below in the periodic table, just to understand that they are also belonging to the group 3, but they are known as inner transition element. Okay. So this is how in the periodic table he classified the groups into 18. Okay. Now let us understand what are the periods. Okay. Periods are nothing but the rows. So how many rows will be there? You can see that only 7 rows will be there. So this 7 rows are known as groups in the periodic table. They are known as what? Periods. They are known as periods. 7 rows are known as period in the modern periodic table. So each rows are known as a period, and how many rows will be there? 1 to 7. And the first period, which is the shortest period here. Why it is the shortest period? You can see that in the first period, only hydrogen and helium will be there. Only hydrogen and the helium will be there. Is it right? And also in the second period, you can see that only 8 elements will be there. Is it right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 elements will be there. That is why the period 1, which is known as the shortest period in the periodic table. Whereas the second period, which also consists of the 8 elements. The second and as well as the third also, which consists of a 8 element, you can count it. And the fourth and fifth element, which is the longest group element, where it consists of 18 element. You can see that the fourth and fifth, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. So the 4 and 5, these periods will be consists of 18 element. Whereas 2 and 3, which consists of only 8 element. Whereas the period 1, which consists of only 2 elements. Is it right? And also if you come to the 6 and 7, if you count, it will get 18 elements. In addition to this, if you add the 14 elements to the period 6, it will become a 32. So you'll get 32 elements in the period 6 and 7. This is how the Henry Moseley, you know, he gave a clear picture about the groups as well as the period in the modern periodic table. So what is a period? Periods are nothing but a horizontal rows. They are nothing but a horizontal rows are known as a period, and there are 7 periods will be there in the modern periodic table. In the first period, you can see that only 2 elements will be there, hence it is known as the shortest period. Whereas a period 2 and 3, you can see that only 8 elements will be placed, hence it is known as one of the second largest period. Whereas a period 4 and 5, you know, that consists of 18 element. When compared to the 4 and 5, you know, 6 and 7, which consists of 32 elements. Hence, it is known as the longest period in the modern periodic table. Which is the smallest or the shortest period is the first period. Which is the longest period? That is the 6th and 7th one. This is how, where the Henry Moseley, he arranged the elements in the particular order just to display in the systematic way. Hope you all understood with the groups and the period in the periodic table. Now let's see how to classify these elements into S, P and D, F block element. So first and foremost, I'll go for the S block element. Okay, let's see what is the S block element. How do we classify in the periodic table? Let's see now. Okay, the S block elements are those in which last electrons will be enters into the S orbital. So when do we say it is a s block element? Only when the last electron enters into the s orbital. How do you say it? Suppose if I take the hydrogen, okay, what is the atomic number of hydrogen? Only one. So then it will be the outermost shell for the hydrogen. That's it, right? You can take the example of lithium also, where the last electron, you can see that it will enter to the s orbital. Such kind of elements are known as s block element, where the last electrons will be enters into the s orbital. And also we have a general electronic configuration to represent this s orbital, that is ns1 and ns2. Okay, ns1 and ns2. Why it is ns1? We have considered this s block element by considering the alkali as well as alkaline earth metal. By considering the group 1 and group 2, we have clubbed together and we say that it is a s block element. Hence, we know that for the group 1, the general electronic configuration is ns1. For the group 2 is ns2. Is it right? So, if you club together, you know, it will become a s block element. Then it will become a s block element. That is why the general electronic configuration to represent this s block element is ns1 or ns2. Okay, the s block element belonging to the group 1 and 2 from the periodic table, and they have situated on the left hand side. So if you see that periodic table, you know, as we have learned in this, you can see that the group 1 element completely and group 2 elements completely together, it is known as s block element. This is together, which is known as what? S block elements. They are known as what? S block element. Now let us understand general characteristics of this s block element. There is a general electronic configuration to know about this s block element, that is ns1 or ns2, or we can write it as a ns1 minus 2, where the last electron can be enters into the s shell. It may be 1 or it may be 2. In the first group element, only one electron will be enters to the s shell, whereas in the group 2 element, we have learned that only 2 electron will be enters to the outermost shell. Hence it is represented as a ns1 minus 2. Okay, either it can be 1, either it can be 2 also. So the s block elements are also known as what? Alkali elements as well as a alkali earth metal. Alkali metals are alkaline earth metals. Okay, and generally they are very reactive. Means when they react with the water, you know, they form a alkali. That is why they are highly active in nature. And also they are electropositive in nature, which means to say that when do we say it is electropositive in nature? Only when it loses the electron, you know, it will gain the plus charge. Is it right? Then only we can say it is a electropositive in nature. And the valence electrons to form a monovalent or the divalent cation. You can take the example of the periodic two element, that is a lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium and cesium. All these elements, you know, they loses one electron and become a monovalent cation. Whereas this magnesium, calcium and strontium and beryllium, you know, they loses the two electron and they get the divalent cation. This is how our s block element, you know, they act like a monovalent or the divalent electropositive in nature. And also they act like a reducing agent. When do we say it is a reducing agent? Only when the reactant undergo oxidation. Only it undergo oxidation. What does a mean of oxidation? Oxidation means removal of electron or loss of electron, which is known as oxidation. That is why all this s block element, you know, they loses the one or the two electron which has been present in the outermost shell, and it act like a reducing agent as well as they behave like a electropositive in nature. And S block elements are forms a ionic compound like sodium chloride, potassium chloride and cesium chloride, etc. So when they combines with the halogens, you know, they usually forms a ionic compound. For example, if I consider the sodium, when it is combines with the halogen, you know, it will forms what? Sodium chloride. We know that the sodium will loses one electron. Is it right? Will loses one electron and behave like a positively charged carrier. Is it right? It gains the positive charge after removing the one electron. Is it right? Like that, our chloride will accept this electron and become chloride minus. Is it right? So when the chloride and the sodium which has been combined, you know, they forms a ionic compound. When the solution, you know, they forms a ion. This is how very interestingly, you know, he build a or he classify the entire element into S, P, D and F. Just now we have learned with the S block element and with the important characteristics. Now let us see with the another characteristics of the P block element. The P block elements are those in which the outer electronic configuration can be represented as NS2NP1 to the NS2NP6, and where the last electron can enters into outermost shell of the P orbital. Outermost shell of the P orbital, they are said to be P block element. So in the periodic table, if I want to show it, so the yellow color which has been shown here, the group 3 to group 18, you know, they are known as P block element. They are known as what? P block. They are belonging to the P block element, where the last electron will be enters into the P block orbital or the P orbital. These elements, they are belonging to the group 3 to 18. So this is a group 13, 14, 15, 16, 17 and 18. From the group 13 to group 18, you know, together we call it as a P block element. We call it as a P block element. P block element. Hope you have understood with the a position in the periodic table. Let's see with the characteristics of this P block element. The general electronic configuration of this P block element will be NS2NP6, where we know that S orbital can accommodate only 2 electrons, whereas the P block element, you know, it can accommodate the electron up to 6. Hence I have written 1 minus 6. Okay. The P block elements include the metals, non-metal as well as the metalloid. If you see this picture, you know, here I have mentioned so many elements in this block. Remember, all this element, they never behave like a metal. Including the metal, you know, we can see the non-metal and also we can see the metalloids which has been present in the P block element. Okay. And these elements are enters into the chemical combination by losing or by gaining or by sharing the valence electron. This block of elements, you know, they never loses the electron on the outermost shell. In addition to this, the sharing, losing and also it will gain the electron during the chemical reaction. And also the group 18 elements are known as noble gases. Already I have explained that this group of elements, you know, they never combine with any other element. Hence it is known as inert gases or the zero group element. So this is a picture about the group 18 element. All those elements, you know, they never combine with any other metal. Hence it is known as the noble gases or the inert gases. And also the group 17 are known as halogen. The group 17, the fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, these are known as halogen because why do they give a halogen name? When they react with the water, you know, they forms a salt. That is why they are known as a halogen family. Okay. The group 16 family, that is the oxygen, sulfur, In this group, you know, they are known as and this one is known as halogen and this is a noble gas. Okay, the group 16 elements are known as chalcogen. Why they have known as a chalcogen? Because these are the elements, you know, group 16 elements are known as chalcogen because these are the element, you know, they have a capacity to form a ore. Hence, it is known as a chalcogen. Whereas, group 17 elements have said that it is a halogen because these element has a capacity to form a salts when they react with the water. Hence, it is formed as a named as a halogen. Like that, the group 15 elements starting from the nitrogen, they are known as nitrogens. They are also known as suffocating gases. When we inhale all these gases, you know, it will become very suffocating to the human beings. Hence, it is also named as nitrogen. This is how for the each group of elements, you know, the Henry Moseley, he named with a different name. Remember, the group 15 elements are known as a nitrogen because they are the suffocating gases. When we inhale, you know, it will be create the respiratory disorder. Like that, the group 16 elements are known as a chalcogen because these elements, you know, they have a capacity to form a ore. Like that, the group 17 elements are known as a halogen family or the halogen group because they form the salts when they react with the water. Like that, the group 18 elements are known as noble gases or the inert gases because they never react with any other element. And remember, all this, the group 13 to 18 in the periodic table, they are collectively known as representative elements or the main elements. They are known as what? Representative element. And the non-metallic characters will be increases when we move from left to right, and the metallic characters will be increases when we move down. That will be understand by studying the periodic trends. Okay. So this is all about the general characteristics of the P block element. Let's see with the D block elements now. Hope you all understood with the S and the P block element. Now let us see what is a D block element, where it is actually situated. The D block elements are those in which the added electron will be goes to the inner d orbital and they have a general outer electronic configuration, that is n minus 1 d 1 to 10 ns 2 or 1 minus 2. This is how we represent the general electronic configurations of the D block element. Remember, we can see this D block element in the periodic table, especially at the middle. Especially from the group 3 to 12, you know, this is known as a D block elements. All blue color elements which represents that they are the D block element. Okay, so the group 3 to group 12, how many elements will be there, you know, that comes under the D block elements. So this D block elements which are belonging to the group 3 to group 12 from the left from the periodic table and situated in the middle between the S and P. Between the S and P orbital, we can see that certain groups of member they have present at the middle, they are known as a D block element. And this D block element, remember, they are known as a transition element. Because they shows the similar characteristics of the S and P orbital, hence it is named as a transition element. Since it is showing the both the characteristics of the S as well as the P orbital, it has been placed in the middle and it is named as a transition element. They are known as a transition element. In the D block elements also, again, which is further divided into series. Okay. So, first one which is known as 3D series. And this is a 4D series, this is a 5D series, and this is a 6D series. Like this, the D block element which is further classified into 4 transition series. When you enter to the second PUC, you'll come to know separate chapter will be there to study about the D and F block element. Okay, under that chapter, you're going to study about the 3D series only. Okay, you'll learn more about the 3D series in your second PUC. So this is how the Henry Moseley, again he divide the D block element into four different transition series, and it is named as a 3D series, 4D, 5D and a 6D series. All these elements in the series, you know, which comprises of 10 elements. If you count it, you know, it consists of 10 elements each in the series. Hope you have understood with the D block element. Let's see with the general characteristics. The D block element have a valence electron in the both outermost shell as well as in the penultimate shell. Both in the valence shell as well as in the penultimate shell, you know, we can expect the electron in the D block element. And they have a general electronic configuration. Remember, that is N minus 1, D 1 to 10, NS 1 to 2. This is a general electronic configuration to represent the D block element. And according to the D block element, you know, they shows the more than one oxidation state. Hence, it is also named as a variable oxidation state. Suppose if you consider the iron, or if you consider the copper, any other element if you consider from this group, you know, or from this block, all these elements, they shows the more than one oxidation state. After losing one electron, you know, they shows a different oxidation state. Hence, it is named as a variable oxidation state. You can take the example of the iron. So, iron can be exhibits in a plus 2, plus 1 form and a plus 2 form. Like that, the copper can also exhibit in a plus 1 format as well as in a plus 2 format. So, this shows a different oxidation state during the oxidation. Hence, it is named as a variable oxidation state in case of the D block element. And also, these elements are usually metal. They have a high melting point and high boiling point. And also, they are forms of colored salts. They usually forms a colored salts. Remember, these are the metal and they have high melting point and a high boiling point. And also, they have a variable oxidation state. And D block elements and their ions and the compounds are generally paramagnetic in nature. What does it mean by paramagnetic? This shows the attractiveness towards the magnetic field. So why they are attracted towards the magnetic field? Because of the unpaired electron. Because of the one or more unpaired electron in the outermost shell, you know, they are attracted towards the magnetic field. Hence, it is named as a paramagnetic in nature. And also, most of these transition elements are act like a good catalyst. So, during the chemical reaction, you know, we use all the some of the elements, especially the iron and the copper, we use as a good catalyst, which will be increases the rate of reaction. Hence, it is known as a catalyst. So, these are the important characteristics of the D block element. Remember, the general electronic configuration you must remember for the all blocks of element. And also the some of the important characteristics. Whereas in the D block, it acts like a variable oxidation state. During the oxidation, they show a different oxidation state. That's it, right? And also they are metal and they have a high melting point and high boiling point. And they forms a colored compound and they act like a paramagnetic in nature. And also these group of elements are known as a transition elements because they show the both the characteristics of the S block as well as with the P block. In addition to this, we have learned that they also act like a good catalyst. Now, let's see with the F block element. Let's see what is the F block, where it is actually situated and what will be the characteristic. Let us discuss now. The F block elements are those which are the element with the ionic form. They have a partially filled F orbital. So, this F block elements are generally known as a elements with the half filled or the partially filled F orbital, because the last electron, that is a differentiating electron, will be enters into the F orbital. So, we know that on the F orbital, there are 7 blocks will be there. Is it right? 7 blocks will be there. Is it right? In a F orbital where the electrons will be enters into the F orbital. Understood? These elements are also known as what? Inner transition element, as I have explained in this. So these two elements, you know, the lanthanide and the actinide together, they are known as inner transition element. They are the inner transition element. Why they are named as the inner transition element? Because they are present inside this lanthanum as well as the actinum. Hence, it is named as a inner transition element. And they belonging to the transition elements only. And it consists of two series. That is a actinide series and a lanthanide series. Remember, this actinide and the lanthanide, they are present in the transition series. But they exhibit the different atomic number. Even though they have a different atomic number, but they show the similar characteristics. Hence, they have placed below in the periodic table. And it is named as a inner transition element. And the lanthanide elements will be having the atomic number from the 58 to the 71, you know, they have been placed below, that is from the lanthanum. It will be start from the lanthanum and it will be end through the atomic number 71. And with those of the inner transition element with the four orbitals are progressively filled. Whereas in case of the actinide, which will be start with the atomic number 90 to the 103, that is from the thorium to the lutetium, you know, it will be start and it will be end. So these elements in the 5 block elements are progressively filled, and the general electronic configuration for this is n minus 2 f 1 to 14 n minus 1 d 1 to 0 0 to 1 and ns 2. This is how the F block elements also, they have given the general electronic configuration where the last electrons will be enters into the F orbital. And the general characteristics of this F block elements are, they have a high melting point and high boiling point because since they are metal. And remember, these elements are radioactive in nature. That is one of the interesting nature of this inner transition element. Especially with the 5F series, you know, we can see that these are the elements, they show the radioactive in nature. And they show the plus 3 oxidation state, that is the common oxidation state of this element. And also, they show the variable oxidation state, maybe from plus 1 to the plus 7. And all these elements, they form a colored source with the source and they absorb the certain wavelength of visible light. Usually they forms a colored source and usually they absorb the light. Okay. These are the characteristics of the F block element. In the next session, we are going to discuss with the nomenclature of element with the atomic number greater than 100. How to nomenclate the or how to name the atomic number more than 100, let us discuss in the next session. Till that, take care and we will meet you in the next session. Thank you.